I spent a few months trying to think of an idea for myself, but unfortunately, John Boyne's novel landed on my desk, and that just blew me away, and I thought, this is a film that has to be made.
I read the book in like a few hours, you know, and I cried like 10 times.
It's a very, really moving film. Really sad. I've cried at the script and at the book.
I think one of the strengths of the film is that it somehow might make the Holocaust comprehensible to young children.
And this is all a story about secrets and lies and about deception and people not understanding their prejudices even though they're right before their eyes.
I think at the heart of the novel, at the heart of the film, is a friendship between two boys who are put together at a terrible time in human history.
You know, it's about loss of innocence. I mean, it's also about racism, you know, which is always with us and is very relevant to today, every day, in any country in the world.
It's a tough subject matter, you know, but the thing is, I think it's always best to approach it with open discussion.
You know, when we had the read-through, I thought, crumbs, you know, this is just such a gripping tale. Just what's going to happen next?
And I think it's misleading to refer to it as a Holocaust film, because it's really so much more about a family.
This is a story about a young German boy and his relationship with a boy inside the camp. But really, the story is told through this young German's eyes.
Hello. Hello. I'm exploring.
A lot of people have read the book, and it's been quite controversial, because an audience who already know what happened in the Holocaust, accepting that here are people who don't know what's happening.
Because they look a bit strange.
What sort of strange?
Mom. I'm sorry. Vegetables.
So I read the script first, and then I read John Boyne's novel, and then I read the script again, and I thought the script did justice to the novel, and the novel simply just was a profound piece of literature.
There are great historians out there. I'm not one of them. I'm not going to write a great history of those times, but what I can do is digest a lot of that information and, you know, create something emotional out of it. I mean, one of the challenges here is to explore a subject which has been explored many, many times in fiction, and to try to find a new way into it.
Well, that's the beauty of the book, isn't it? These two kids, these innocent kids, are blind of any prejudice or any of this going on from either side of the fence. Don't know actually what's going on.
Mark is fantastic to work with, because he has so many strings to his bow. He's done a superb adaptation of this book, probably is because he's a director as well as a writer.
I found it was a very, very faithful adaptation. I felt most of the novel was contained in the script, but the scenes that were added were scenes that could have been in the novel, in a different form of it. I thought he was very sensitive to that.
This is a film that's set in 1940s Berlin. Budapest itself doubles for Berlin. Also, we're shooting in a concentration camp. There's already a set for a concentration camp here. It's a city which has great flexibility and many possibilities for many different sorts of places.
Establishing Berlin in 1940, whatever it is, and using Budapest as your blank canvas was not too much of a problem.
We came to Budapest because it offered both the opportunity to find a period street locations that would double for Berlin, plus the landscapes around Budapest seemed to have a kind of Central European feel to them, which is what we needed for our camp.
This is not a film about pretty pictures. It's a film about truth.
I've asked thousands and thousands of questions and done a lot of research on our uniforms, and we have this fantastic man in Poland who helps us with our uniforms. You know, the uniform was very important. The whole design of everything within, you know, this time was taken very, very seriously. And actually, the cut of these SS uniforms is very... It's very slick and it's very flattering. I hate to say it, but it's a very stylish uniform.
With David Thewlis and with Rupert Friend, just being as accurate as possible, giving it an Aryan feel, especially with Rupert, who we started off, he had long dark hair. So to get his character right and believable was a slight challenge.
You know, Elsa became sort of a compilation of all the women, of diaries and journals in my research that I read of various women in the Third Reich.
I think we wanted to say that she's not letting the war affect her look. And I think, you know, for certain people that could happen, you know, for people who either came from very rich families or, you know, their husbands were high up in, you know, in military or in business.
I think, you know, in a way, the period, the costume, you know, the sets are doing the period. I think this is their job. I think my job is to make it right, you know, on the day. I don't really believe in kind of period lighting. I'm lighting the film like if it was like a nowadays film. Because I think they've done a beautiful job with the costumes and the sets, and I don't want to add another layer to this.
I think we both agree that the look of the film actually comes, it evolves when you're shooting, in a way. There's a lot of elements of the look of this film that happened by happy accident.
I'm trying to be very spontaneous with everything on the set. I can be excited by something, you know, at the last second, and say to Mark, oh, look at this. And him the same with me. So, you know, we don't have any storyboard. We just, things come like this.
One element we have in this film is that there's an awful lot of stripes, not just in pajamas, but in the background, in the banisters and the trees by the house. It's always there's a bit of a theme throughout the film, is that, well, these bars and these stripes.
We realised that one of the hardest challenges for us is to convince an audience about people's naivety about the final solution. I mean, obviously, we all know that there were these extermination camps with this genocide going on.
It's a gradual unveiling of the layers of what's really going on. You don't really understand, even when we come to the camp, you don't understand it's an extermination camp until later, you know, because there were very many different kinds of camp. But, you know, this is obviously the very worst.
And we did quite a lot of research to try and understand what it would have been like for the families of commandants at camps. And we did, to our amazement, because we wondered, first of all, whether it was credible that an 8-year-old boy wouldn't understand what was going on the other side of the fence. But when we looked into the memoirs of the commandant at Sobibor and the commandant at Auschwitz, two things emerged, which is both their wives actually hadn't known for quite a while what was going on in the camps, and both thought they were labor camps.
It wasn't covered in the book, that area of what the mother knew, what she didn't know, really. And that was an element I found out in research, was this, you know, the fact that the commandants were sworn to death to keep it from, not allowed to tell anybody, including their own family.
They smell even worse when they burn, don't they?
What? She's a bit oblivious to what unfolds around her. She chooses to be oblivious. Elsa's world starts off very small. You know, she only concerns herself with what affects her family, you know, the safety of her family, her and her position in society.
Well, I don't think I've researched any film as much as this for years and years and years and years, if ever, because I felt a great duty to do that. It wasn't a matter of just turning up, learning the lines and putting on a costume with this particular film, because it's this part I find harder to play than many parts I've played, again, if not the most difficult.
You believe in this too. You want this country to be strong.
No, Ralph, no!
No, not that!
I think on some level she does intuit. She knows that people are being horribly mistreated. I feel like she doesn't look. She doesn't want to see because seeing it would implicate her husband and it would implicate herself.
Thank you.
I play a boy called Bruno who's 8 years old, the same as Shmuel. And I make a really strong friendship when we move to the countryside because my dad's just got a new job.
The first time I saw Asa, who is playing Bruno, was when he ran onto the set for the opening scene of the film, running through the cafes of Berlin with his three best friends for life. And he's a very striking little boy. He's got very piercing eyes. But he's very focused on what he's doing as well. I think the key to Bruno is that the audience has to really care about him. You know, you have to be invested in his fate. And from what I've seen of his performance so far, I think they really will be. I think he's somebody that you're going to care about.
He's got a fantastic face, and he's just very... his expressions are incredible. And you just knew that, you know, with a bit of coaching, he's going to get there with the words and the delivery. But he just had that magical look.
He's called Mark, and
yeah.
I reckon he's a really nice director. I work well with him.
He's done about a few films.
I'm so cool.
Jack, who possessed a real stillness and a sort of solemn, a sort of a sad quality about him, but at the same time, as I said, an inner strength.
This is me, who is Shmuel, and as Asa said, I'm also 8 years old. I don't have much of a happy life that Bruno has.
I have to go back now.
Really?
It was nice to meet you,
Shmuel.
And you, Bruno.
I knew a bit about the Holocaust and about...
Yeah, I had to learn about that a bit. From books.
Yeah, I knew a few things, but not as much as I do now.
Both of Asa and of Jack, I don't think they're of this earth. I think they're divine little creatures. I mean, if you just look at their eyes. In each scene, I watch the monitor, and it's the dueling of the eyes. They've both got these sort of gaping celestial holes in their faces, you know, and it's effortless. It's effortless with them, and you just tell him once, and he adjusts so easily, and he takes a lot of cues from us, as Amber does as well. But I think I think there's so much to be learned from working with children.
You're not a doctor.
Yes, I am.
No, you're not. You peel potatoes.
I practiced as a doctor before I came here.
You couldn't have been much good then if you had to practice.
As for Asa, it's his movie. I mean, if that young boy doesn't turn in a performance, we do not have a film, we do not have a story. And that young boy, for the age of 8, to have such professionalism and under that pressure... I mean, this is, what, a three-month shoot? He's in 120 out of 140 scenes. I really take my hat off to that kid. He's very, very special.
It's been a new experience for me. I've never worked with children this young before, and having to do what my character has to do with them is not by any means sort of easy or pleasurable.
Are you eating? Have you been stealing food? Answer me.
It was okay in sort of like the rehearsals because
he didn't actually shout.
He was just talking a bit loud, talking a bit louder when he was meant to shout on the takes. But when it did actually get to the takes, it was quite scary.
Have you been eating? Have you been stealing food?
sir. He gave it to me.
When the first day we were down at the fence location was the first day we saw Shmuel, well, I saw Shmuel, I hadn't been to any of the fittings or anything. And, you know, you have to go, well, I found, like, I think quite a few people on the, you have to go away and just have a cup of coffee, because it is very, very upsetting to see an eight-year-old with his head shaved behind barbed wire. What is hard about it is you just can't understand how it occurred. And even though you've done all this research, you've read all the books, you still just think, well, how did somebody not say, no, I can't partake in this, I can't involve myself in this?
There's a propaganda film called The Führer Gives the Jews a City that was used in the war that painted the camps as a nice place to be. In our story, it needs to be brand new. It's only just been shot, so we decided to recreate it ourselves.
The film itself is a little bit dog-eared, so Mark has decided to reshoot it, to re-dramatise it in the film, so that it's faster, more high-impact, so that Bruno has a few glimpses of it and understands what's being said.
We did organise the football game that was shot in the original film. We recreated that, but also gardening, and I think that was about it for what we covered. But it was a very strange experience to be shooting that as propaganda, because we almost felt like propagandists ourselves. We were, you know, telling all these Hungarian extras to just look as though they're enjoying themselves.
Organized sport is very popular. Those that don't play certainly enjoy watching.
Mark put that as a crucial point in the film, where to show us where Bruno thinks he knows what the camp is like, because he's seen a propaganda film that's showing him that it's an okay place.
To see the film as a fable is to see the disintegration of the family, and hopefully there lies the punishment for the father's sins. I mean, on Monday we're shooting the very last shot of the film, which is my realization of what's just happened, and I'm very, very unsure how to play it, you know, because it's because it is the very, very end of the film, and it's like, what should we understand from this journey and what's happened, without talking about exactly what happens, but it's obviously incredibly horrific.
How do I look?
A scene in which I felt a lot of pressure. Surely it's one of the last images, and it's the culmination of a story. And then we start wailing, and it's raining, and we're I'm bereft, and the guilt is upon my head, and Amber hears me sobbing, and she begins to cry.
And Vera really helped me, because, I mean, it wasn't hard to go along, because she was easy to follow, and she was very helpful to me.
Bruno!
And I was talking to Mark, the director, the other day, saying, actually, I think we really need to do quite a number of takes when we come to do that, or just keep the camera rolling, because I'm not quite sure how to sum it up in just one expression. And Vera, who plays my wife, has the same job, and Amber, who plays Gretel, the same. It's an extraordinary ending to a film. It's a very sudden, very stark ending to a film.
I think we're all united on this production and feeling that we've been making something with a really valuable moral imperative about it. And so it's fantastic to feel you're working on something that's worthwhile.
People should see and can see and be moved and affected and come away with a greater understanding of the personal cost of tragedies such as this.
I think people have felt they owe it to Holocaust survivors worldwide and to the memory of this atrocity, to try and do a very good job so that the film lasts, and if the film lasts and has an impact, then our memory will stay.
The further we get away from the era of the Holocaust, it's very, very easy for us to forget. Not, I don't mean our generation, but the generation coming through, it's always at one remove from them, and I think we need to be constantly reminded.
I think it's a film that parents should... all parents should take their kids to, although it's not specifically a children's film. I think it's very educational in a way. Maybe accidentally so, but I think it is.
I mean, maybe it's naive. Maybe I'm being as naive as Bruno in this. But I do feel a certain responsibility that when I talk to children in schools and when I tackle these subjects with them, that I do say to them, you know, you guys are the ones who are going to be running the world in 20, 30 years. It's up to you to decide whether you want to have more Brunos and Schmuels or whether you don't want that to happen again.